Good luck topping this, mate.
John!
I suppose the money is out.
That's very good, right. John Little.
But I have not yet had my shot.
Jason Brawley.
James Hunter.
I'm live. I just showed that clip of you splitting that arrow.
Wasn't that an amazing shot, Jamie?
It was. I like it.
Have you ever seen such splendid skill in your life?
I have not.
I trained many, many months for that scene, I must admit.
Yes.
It was tough at first, but I learned to do it.
Yeah, you got
first
good.
Shot, first try too.
Really?
No, that wasn't me. Wasn't me at all.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I would have had the arrow.
Did you
back.
Ever practice with a bow? Like, was that ever an interest of yours, like archery?
Just as a little kid.
Yeah.
And never passed that.
So
no.
that bug, even after Robin Hood, it didn't really appeal to you. You didn't ever practice or try it.
No, but neither did wearing leotards or whatever we wore, you know.
You didn't go out and buy a quarter staff and start fighting neighbors?
You know, I think I would love to have I have always wanted a quarter staff.
Yeah.
I think I'll get a quarter staff.
No, I didn't have that desire.
Well, you know, I picked it up even before that. I mean, after I had gotten all those bows, I set up a target in my backyard and I would practice. And I nearly ruined this old pine tree that I had in my backyard.
I thought you might say a dog or something.
No, I never went that far.
Sorry, Miss McGillicuddy.
Yeah, sorry. Burp, burp.
Yep.
I'll go get you another one.
But you've never hunted or anything like that?
Well, you know, my parents were divorced when I was 1 year old, so I never really, I was around my father, but he never took me hunting or anything like that. But I have an interest, to answer your question, no, I've never really been a hunter, but I like guns. I've always liked guns, and I've always shot guns. And I went to see my dad one summer, I guess it was somewhere in late fall, maybe even early winter, in Georgia. And his neighbor asked me if I wanted to go hunting. I said, sure, duck hunting. I'd never been bird hunting. And we went, and all these men had all this camo on and waders and, you know, you name it, they had it. They looked like Elmer Fudd. But I had nothing. I had blue jeans and white Nikes and a jacket. That's all I had. So they all went to the pond and were doing it like you're supposed to, shooting in the water, from the water, rather. And I was out in some kind of field. And
probably a cornfield or
next thing you know, here comes a patch of ducks, flock of ducks, I don't know what you call them. And I went boom, boom, had a pump 12 gauge. I killed two ducks and that one little patch of birds. And then another patch came later, and I killed another one. So I got three ducks in like 15 minutes, and none of those guys got one duck.
Oh, wow.
So,
and then what'd you do with them? Did you eat them, or just stuffed them?
We ate two of them, and my dad was going to have the third one stuffed, so he put it in the freezer and then never did it. So
yeah,
I didn't get my stuffed duck. I don't have any kind of stuffed animals on my walls that I've killed. I mean, I don't know that I've ever killed another bird except those three ducks. So, but I love guns and I like being out with a shotgun in the fall or my 22, you know, there's something about that. Deer hunting, freezing to death. No way. I don't like it.
Well,
you don't see anything. You go, oh, shh, don't breathe. Don't breathe. Don't breathe. Just sit. Well, I didn't even have anybody to talk to. I just stuck me out in the woods and I just sat there for hours and I just couldn't do that.
Yeah, it's work for sure. I mean, my uncles on my mom's side are all, I mean, they live in the woods of Tennessee and they love to hunt and they've hunted deer probably every year during hunting season. They probably don't do it anymore. They're too old. Well, a couple of them died even, but they really got into it. I mean, they were doing the whole, you know, building the, the tree towers and stuff and really getting into it. They probably bagged two or three deer, you know, a year. And actually one of them gave me a stuffed buck head that I had on my wall for several years. And it was funny. I was dating a girl when I was a teenager, and she came over and she's like, "Ooh, what is that?" Like, why do you have that there? I'm like, "Don't worry, I didn't kill it. It was my uncle's, you know." But I've never been. The one time I went deer hunting, it was kind of a disaster. Actually,
you killed somebody.
Not that bad of a disaster, but I did. The second time I went was actually really nice because we actually took horses. So we, you know, as you can imagine.
That's awesome.
Yeah, we had our, you know, our shotguns strapped to our rifles, strapped to our horses, and, you know.
Feeling like a real bunch of men, weren't
you? Yeah, it felt like that. It really did feel like that. But the thing is we never saw a deer. We were just out there with our guns, like, you know, riding around on horses.
Looking cool.
Yeah, looking cool. That was about it. So, but the first or second time I went, we were on foot. And we were mostly just shooting at turkeys or birds or whatever we saw. It was, oh, there's something that's breathing. You know? any living creature we just shot at.
Hey, Ted, I think I saw something breathe over there.
Yeah.
Let's kill it.
But anyway, we were coming down. There was like a little embankment of dirt. I don't know if we were crossing like a dirt road or what, but you know how you come out and it'll be like a dip where the road is cut out of the hill or whatever?
Yeah.
So somehow we were running. I don't know if we were running towards something or away from something, but I tripped. And it was me or my cousin one. I can't remember which one of us tripped. But I tripped and fell and rolled down the hill, and my shotgun hit the dirt road and just broke into like three pieces.
Oh my God.
So I was That's like, hilarious. It wasn't even my shotgun. So I was like, whoops.
Has anybody got any Elmer's glue?
Well, we were just lucky that it didn't go off, you know.
Yeah.
Kill one of us. You know, a shotgun split in three pieces, shells flying everywhere. And it was like, wow, dude, like we shouldn't be out here. We don't know what we're doing. Because we were really young, you know. Like imagine being 16. There's no adults with us. We're all like 16, 17, 15. We're all out in the woods, just us with guns. You know,
There's nothing wrong with that if the guys grew up with guns.
Yeah, and we all kind of did. Well, they did, for sure. One of them did. I don't know. Me, I mean, my dad was never a hunter. My dad was a city boy. Yes and no. He was half-half. He loved the woods. He loved doing all that. But he wasn't a big hunter.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, that was my one experience with it, and I just kind of was like, I don't know, this, I don't, maybe this isn't for me. But I've never seriously gone out and tried to hunt.
Me either. I've made homemade traps before, just to know how to do it.
Yeah. So I mean, I do love venison, that's for sure. And the one meat that I've been trying to get my hands on is elk, because I heard elk is really healthy, but it's hard to get and it is expensive.
Well, beef is through the roof.
Oh, I know. Even beef, you know, is a lot now. But so you've kept guns your whole life. You've got a collection, or you just have a couple?
No, I've got a little collection. Nice. Nothing big.
Yeah. Well, anyway, it's in California, it's not easy. You know, it's not as easy as, I mean, the laws out here are absolutely ridiculous. You know, the gun laws in California are, I could compare them to like the weed laws in Alabama. They're completely, you know, unreasonable.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's just, you know, it is what it is. I mean, I don't see how having those restrictions has helped stop any kind of crime out here at all. In fact, it's probably even helped the criminals in a way when you try to disarm the public like that. And I mean, they're really not. I mean, there are gun stores out here. You can own a gun. You can even get, you know, a permit, but it ain't easy. You got to go through a lot of red tape.
There's nothing but red tape in that. In California.
Oh, I know. And it's just gotten worse and worse and worse over the years. It's not getting any better. But anyway.
No.
So, yeah, I mean, that's okay. You want to do all that stuff, you can go to Texas. You can go to Montana. I think probably even Northern California is nothing like, you know, L.A. or San Francisco. I mean, it's, you know, I've been up to Northern California. It's kind of a different world. It's not at all anything like how it is in the big city. So it's just, California is a big state, so there's different pockets of, you know, normal people.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I saw on Facebook where you've been doing Elvis gigs, and I want to talk about it.
Yeah, I started that back up a few months ago. I thought I was done. I'd never planned on doing it again, but I kept getting people asking me to do it, and I thought, well, it's money, and I like singing. Why not? I'm about to get too old. I've lost too much hair, but still got the chops.
Yeah, well, I saw a couple of those clips. It sounded good. Now, where are you doing this, and how are you getting these gigs?
That was at my church in Fairhope, Alabama, at Three Circle. It's called Three Circle Church.
So you're just doing it at church, or are there other venues?
No. That was my church asked me to do that. They were sort of doing made a game for a Christmas special. They had a game, had a portion of it that was set up like a game show, and you know, they'd say, spin that wheel, and you've got to sing the song Jingle Bells, like, and then the other part of the dial would say Elvis Presley, or you've got to sing White Christmas, like Darius Rucker. So it was kind of funny, but they made it look like they were spontaneously spinning that wheel, and the audience said, spin that wheel, and they'd spin it, and so they had, you know, a female sing like some pop star that I don't remember her name, and then they had a couple of guys sing, and then they had a guy sing a song, a Christmas song, like Elvis Presley, but, and, you know, he's got a very, very high voice. So he did a good job with it, and people clapped and everything, but, you know, he's, he wasn't fully engaged in it. And then all he sits down, and the guy across from him says, "You know, that sure was good. But to do Elvis, you know, you really got to have the look and the sound and the suit and you got to have the whole deal." I know. I wish we had, if we just had somebody in the building. And as he says that, I burst out on stage. I said, "Step aside, son." I said, "All right, Dave, give me an E." And then I sing Blue Christmas. And, of course, the audience was having a ball, and I was having a ball. If the audience is having a ball, I'm having a ball. And it was a blast. I've sang for a lot of people. I've never sang for that many people at one time.
Well, I'm sure it felt good, and it always does, that type of stuff. But the thing is about you is that you do have a real Elvis vibe. Like, a lot of times when I see so-called impersonators, it's really not working, man. I got to tell you, like, it's just, yeah, like, yeah, you're dressed like Elvis. You're trying to, you did your hair up and all this, and you kind of maybe sound like him, but I'm not feeling the vibe, you know. But whenever you start to talk like him or do him, or with the videos I've seen you of your impersonations, you've got that Elvis vibe, man. Like, you feel it. Like, and so, I don't know. You might want to really, I don't know, man. Maybe you might want to take a trip to Vegas. You can get booked, dude. I'm telling you.
You know? I don't know. I've never felt confident enough to go out there, especially not my age right now. But
well, you let me know, because since I'm a degenerate poker player, whenever you want to go out there, I'll hook you up. We'll go out there, and I'll lose all my money, and you can make money impersonating Elvis.
Hey, Jamie, we ain't got no money left. What are we going to do? I don't know. Why don't you go sing?
I'll tell you what. Give me a minute. I'm going to go over here and mortgage my home, and I'll get us out of the hole.
Give me about an hour. Let me sing. We'll go get us a sandwich, peanut butter and banana sandwich.
I don't know. I think you're really good. I mean, I think that you would have been very good in an Elvis biopic, like a movie about Elvis. I think you would have worked. I think you would have worked very well, actually. So
yeah, thank you.
But I think, and you know, look. There's a lot of people that can emulate Elvis. I mean, this kid who did it in that latest movie, I mean, him by himself without all that get up, he looks nothing like Elvis. I mean, really, not as much.
No, but he was good.
He was good because he's a good actor, but I'm saying naturally, like, if you were to walk, you know, past him on the street, you wouldn't think that he looked like anything like Elvis. I mean, he's got his own look. But yeah. You, if you walk by you on the street, someone would say, "Wait a minute, was that Elvis?" That's my point.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, it's with you, it's more natural. But I always wanted to do a biopic of Nicholson. I think I do a good impersonation. If I don't really impersonate him, but there's certain ways that I might favor him that I think I could get away with. Like, if they ever did like a life story of him, I could probably do that.
There's an actor, and I wish I could remember his name, and you look so much like him. He was in a movie with Nicole Kidman and
Tom Cruise.
No, no, sorry, old chap, different person. I was going to say Pee Wee Herman.
Oh, thank you. That's a huge compliment. He was an incredible. Yeah, he was an incredible talent. But I think I've told you before how much I love that first movie he did, Big Adventure.
I absolutely love Pee Wee Herman. I love that. I love this kids show.
Yeah.
It was funny as hell. But I love the big Pee Wee's Big Adventure. I don't know how many times I've seen it, and I have to see it about once every couple of years.
Yeah.
Like, you guys want to watch Pee-wee's? It just, I laugh constantly.
Oh, he's got a good story also.
He was brilliant. And you know, he was a good actor because he disappeared for many years after that incident at the movie theater. But then just a few years ago, we saw him in several shows, and he was very good. And he usually played a villain, and he plays a good villain.
Yeah, he does. He has Burton also used him in a couple other roles, or the very dark type roles. He was in Batman Returns as the Penguin's dad. A couple of roles he's done that have been dark, which kind of goes with the territory. I mean, there's parts of Pee-wee that are dark. But, yeah, I like that character. But, you know, a lot of people don't get him. And a lot of people only focus on the controversies behind him. But, by the way, the really bad one, none of it was actually proved. It was all just allegations. Because there were allegations beyond what happened in the movie theater. I don't know if you're aware.
No.
But, yeah, anyway, it's just probably, you know, there's no real, you know, I don't. Just because someone is accused of something, that's not enough for me to condemn them in my mind. I'm going to need something more real. Like, I need to see the evidence.
Besides, that has no effect on how I feel about his acting ability.
Oh, I agree.
Those movies. However, there's some actors, I don't even want to see them in anything. They have become so strange and get involved in so many things and are so vocal about everything that I can't watch a movie and not think of that. Yeah, but I can watch Pee Wee Herman and just laugh my butt off.
You know? And there's a lot of those, by the way, now. It's getting more of those now than not. I mean, I really don't care if I see another movie with Leonardo DiCaprio in it at all. And there's a bunch, and I'm not singling him out. And I'm not saying he's a bad actor, but I'm done. Like, there's a lot of faces that are just overused, like too much. But I don't know. I just think if people get old for a while, you got to give, you know, new. But, you know, you look at what is considered a movie star now. Like, what is it? This little dude, Timothy Chalamet, where they're putting him in everything. I don't see any talent with this guy. So it's like, maybe I'm just getting old. I'm an old fart. But I don't really see that how he's a leading man in anything. But I guess the public's perception of what that is changes, you know. And so, you know, I guess it can't always be Burt Reynolds.
Yeah, I mean, it's just hard when people want – the whole people in that kind of position want to force their views on everyone, and you're not allowed to have your own opinion. And when they continue to do that, it hurts for me. It hurts. I don't want to see them. There's one particular person. I love his acting. It's great.
Who is that?
I'm not going to mention it.
Why not? I got to know now.
I see the point. But, anyway, it doesn't matter. The bottom line is act. Why do you have to get involved? You know, Bono is an original kind of rock star who I think has done a lot of good for people. But not everybody is going to be a Bono.
Right. Well, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I'm not really, you know, that cult has pretty much taken over, I mean, the mainstream. So we all know what that is, and I'm not going to waste my time talking about it. But, you know, look. Hollywood's dead. It's been dead, as I said, for several years now. I mean, once they started to stop shooting on film, that was kind of the beginning of it. But and now with all this, you know, with this woke cult, you know, what is it? What can you do now? I mean, it's amazing. I mean, Disney is probably at the forefront of this and has stopped at nothing to ruin every single franchise they get their hands on.
Yeah.
And that's too bad. I'm not sure what they think they're going to achieve by that. They certainly haven't. It certainly hasn't done them any favors, even from a money standpoint. So I'm not sure what the end game here is for these people.
Well, they're doing a lot of crazy things, and I don't want them to have my money anymore.
I agree, and I've cut the cord from many of these. You know, I haven't been on. You know, I like, as I said, I told you, I've even stopped subscribing to Netflix. I've been off them for almost a year now, and I really have no desire to go back. There's too many other options, you know, Tubi, Pluto TV, Amazon, where you can pretty much buy your own stuff, even though Amazon hasn't done anything great either. But, yeah, and I just hope that there can be a return to independent cinema at some point. There are a few holdouts, like Tarantino, who, by the way, just purchased a movie theater in East Hollywood, Silver Lake, called the Vista Theater, and is trying to. There's a few filmmakers in the corner that are trying to preserve, you know, the way cinema should be preserved. There was another theater that was bought by several directors in Westwood, the Fox Theater, where most of the movie premieres have taken place over the years.
Mm-hmm.
Which, and I like that kind of stuff. I'd like to see more of a movement to get, you know, movies made on film, actually, and then step away from digital cinema. But now we've entered into a whole different realm, which is the realm of AI, which has... you know, complicated that even further. I'm afraid that I got to tell you, I'm afraid this AI thing is going to be the final nail in the coffin for celluloid, because it's too easy, and the seduction of it is going to be too great for people to resist. I mean, if they rolled over that easy for digital, you know, are you going to watch and see how quickly they're going to roll over for AI?
It's a dangerous invention, in my opinion.
I agree.
And it's with me trying to, and I say, break into voiceover work. I haven't really done much of anything at all other than work on my demo, and I did a couple realty things, but I forgot what I was talking about.
Well, I'll tell you something. It'd be easy for anyone who is listening to this podcast of us to take a sample of our voice and put it into an AI program, and they'd never need us for another job again, because they have our voice. They can put our voice to anything at that point. That's how far it's gotten already.
I didn't realize that. I was going to say that, yes, it's going to hurt the voiceover industry, but I think there will always be a need for a real live actor, because there are just certain inflections that artificial intelligence has not mastered. Although I will say, it, like you say, it's progressing very fast. Who knows how quickly it's going to progress further and what it's going to be able to do. I hope it doesn't put us out of work that I have yet to even get, despite it's, such a new thing, you know, AI. Anyway, we'll just have to see how it goes.
Well, it won't affect, people say, you know, that, like that, like it, like they have to be a part of it, and they don't. I mean, anyone can decide to to do their own thing and buy a film camera, buy some film stock, and make a real movie. You know, that no one has to go along with this. That's the thing that people don't realize. But it's the question is are you going to invest the money in that? And are you going to really, I mean, is that really what, you know, what you want to do? You know, if you, the medium can always be preserved. You just have to kind of ignore all that other stuff. Like you and I, you know, if I secured a budget for Robin Hood 2, we'd go out here and shoot it just like we did in 1992. And it, none of this stuff would matter. We would do it the exact same way. And, you know, maybe some of that computer stuff would help in the editing. But that would be about it. You know, the process of cinema and making a movie has not changed over the past 100 years. It's only these new technologies that people have allowed to change it. And so I just say ignore it for the people who really want to, you know, have a career that's going to last and who really want to invest in something worthwhile. Ignore it. And of course, there's going to be people that are going to very strongly disagree with that. Well, I totally disagree. It's time to start investing in AI, and we're going to make a lot of money, and it's going to be great. And it's going to be, you'll just sit at a computer and basically type in what you want. I can make a whole movie. Just type a paragraph. A whole movie will pop out of my computer. Isn't that great? Well, no, I don't think it is. And I don't really think that's how you should make a movie, to be honest. And there was a filmmaker. Do you know this Japanese guy? And forgive me, I think it's Miyazaki, but you know the Ghibli movies from Japan, the Ghibli animated films? Have you ever seen any Ghibli movies?
I don't think so.
They're really beautiful. Like one of them is called Howl's Moving Castle. And they're some of the most beautifully animated by hand films if ever made. I think they're better than any Disney, or at least as good as any original Disney animated film. But he made a comment that that this AI thing is kind of an insult. It's kind of an insult to humanity. He even went as far as saying that. And all the old timers are going to go against it. None of the old timers are going to say, yeah, this is a good replacement for something that we've been doing for 100 years. So, I mean, if you want to support it, I think that's fine. You go support it, but I'm not going to. I'm going to just continue to do whatever I can do. Yeah, the old way is always best for me.
Well, look, they've brought back the 33 album. I mean, look how popular it is. If I had one of the coolest 33 album players, and it had it was Sylvania. It was from the 60s, and it was heavy as all get out, but had a big handle on it, and the turntable folded out. I mean, you set this thing down, it looked like a suitcase, then the turntable folded out, and the back part was two separate speakers that were connected by cord, of course, and you just spread them across the room, and it was very a cool setup. I wish I had not gotten rid of it. And I got rid of all my albums. And look how people are, you know, my son bought a turntable and started collecting a few albums. I don't know what the fascination is. I like the placing it on the turntable, you know, placing the album on the turntable and putting the needle down. I mean, I like.
You make a very, very, very good point. And I'll tell you why. It's a good point because it's interesting to see that even after CDs, a cassette, CDs, and now this digital stuff, that how people love, how many people still prefer vinyl over all that stuff. Just the way that it sounds, the when mm-hmm. you set it up, like the quality of the sound in your home, is so much better than having
It's actually. I love, like, back in the 50s and 60s and 70s and whatever, you know, it was they used to have those long stereo systems, sometimes as combos, TV and radio, but usually it was just a radio, and it looked like furniture. It was it was beautiful. It had like crisscross designs on the front, but you slide the front open and get to the insides, and the turntable was on the top, speakers were on the front. And just the idea of grabbing a record and taking it out of the sleeve and placing it on there and putting the needle down, it's kind of like how Japan views tea. You know, they don't just microwave some water. They have a special pot, and it's a ritual.
It's art.
And there's, you know, I like smoke a cigar every now and then, or a pipe, and that there's something besides the aroma. I like the feel of a cigar in my hand, or a pipe, and I like packing the tobacco down, and it's kind of, you're not in a hurry when you do it. So same with having a sip of tea, same with putting an album on. It was a time to, let's have some fun, let's dance or something. It wasn't like today where you've got anything you could want, be it video or radio, or like Spotify or whatever, Pandora. I mean, you got that at your fingertips. But
see, that's the trap, Jason. That's how they trap you, is that yes, you have this incredible convenience, but you are also incredibly limited to where you're going to get this from. It's either going to be Spotify, YouTube, one or two others, right?
Oh, yeah.
As opposed to physical media, which I'll always prefer. And even with like DVDs and Blu-rays, I love the feel of looking at the cover art of a Blu-ray, taking it out, putting it in my, player. I can play it, stop it anytime I want. The quality is better. Or I have to depend on streaming services. I have to depend on Netflix, Disney Plus, Paramount Plus, Amazon, all this other crap, that if I don't have the physical media and I want to watch, say, something, I can't because I don't have that service. So that's how they trap you. And I got to be honest, I really think that's what all this is about. I think they want to limit, like limit the possibilities of us owning any media ourselves. They want to keep it all for themselves. And if you want to pay, we'll dole it out a little bit to you here at a time. They want to take away that ownership. And that goes for everything.
Well, I have to admit, though, I don't listen to CD. I haven't played a CD in I don't know how long. I don't have that many CDs anyway, but I like Spotify because I listen to music when I'm creating art or working out.
No, it's great. I mean, in and of itself. But what I'm saying is, take that away. You know, take Spotify away, and what are your options?
Well, right, and I admit I'm trapped because like with I just wouldn't listen to all the music I listen to if I didn't have Spotify. I was very limited what I had.
And by the way, the trap goes both ways. It goes for consumers and the producers of the product. And they want to put a monopoly on all this digital stuff, and now they're going to put a monopoly on all the AI. So at some point, very soon, there's going to be the chance to independently produce your own stuff is going to be way more limited than people think, because you're going to be too reliant on those companies that own all that stuff. And people are going to own it. They're going to put a stamp on it, you know? And so, yeah, that's why it's always better. Physical media and independent film is the way to go for me. I mean, I don't get a good feeling about where any of this is going, really. And I don't think that the convenience of it is really worth the cost, the ultimate cost of what we're going to have to pay. So that's just my opinion.
Well, it's killed the record business.
Right.
I mean, it's killed it.
Yeah. So anyway, hey, look, it, like I said, it doesn't affect, you know, the way that we produce art and the way that I've decided to do it. But, and I'm fine with that. You know, I tried to get on board for many years and was like, hey, maybe this will work out. Maybe this is just the way it's got to be now. But, you know, like I said, and I've said it many times, I just don't think that's, I don't think it's good anymore. So, but yeah, I mean, I continue to work and I try to do, you know, continue to do stuff, but the enthusiasm for me is just not there anymore. I mean, to do my own stuff, it is, but just other people's stuff, it really doesn't matter to me much.
Yeah.
So, and I mean, if, and this is a big if I'm never able to produce my own stuff again, the stuff that I did do, even though it was ages ago, that's good enough for me. I mean, at least I was able to do that, you know, so.
Well, yeah, I certainly wasn't doing things like that when I was your age.
But this new Robin Hood script, and you've read it, I'm very proud of it. And it's, even though it is heavily influenced from that British show, Robin of Sherwood, and some of it, a lot of it's not, maybe it's, you know, 30% that. I like it. I like it a lot. And I think it's a script that deserves, of all of my scripts, that one deserves to be produced. And, I just love the story. And it's funny how when I write stuff, and I wrote that maybe 2-3 years ago now, seems like forever.
Yeah.
And what's weird, I'll tell you what's weird, is I have very little memory of writing it. And when I read it, it's kind of hard for me to, I'm kind of like, wow, did I write this?
Yeah, I know what you're saying.
Wow, this is really good. I can't believe I wrote this.
I'm that way about my artwork sometimes, some of it. I'm like, wow, I can't believe I made that.
That kind of proves to me, Jason, that there's a spiritual aspect to art.
Of course there is.
but you know, I seek proof, you know. And to me, that's a good proof that it is. That I have no cognitive sort of reference to how I got that out of me. I mean, besides the fact that I did borrow from that show, but I'm not talking about that. But it is a love letter to that show because I love it so much. And to Robin Hood, the legend of Robin Hood in general. And I just like the way that I bridged everything from our film into this new world. I love and how...
It was a fun script to read. It looks fun. I could... At first I thought, am I going to have a hard time imagining... picturing this scene in my head, because I have ADD really bad, and sometimes I can read the same sentence literally 10 times in a row and I still don't know what it said, and I have to just put the book down and come back to it. But I was immediately enthralled with that script, and it was easy to read, and I enjoyed it. I could picture everything in there, and that's a very hard thing for me to do. And I was in that Steve Martin play, a lot of the scenes I had a hard time picturing them until we did them. Then it just all clicked, it all gelled. But that's just, I'm not your typical learner. I learn in different ways.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it. And yeah, that is the top of my list, you know, of things I want to do before I check out, baby. So we'll see, God willing. And yeah, there's a bunch of projects I want to dip my hands in and just kind of go it on my own and do it my own way. But you know, time is money and money is power, and it's all really about the financing. And so that's about it. It's a very expensive craft. I mean, it's a very expensive medium. What can I say?
Yeah.
But there are ways to get around that. There are some little neat little tricks that you can do to, you know, Robin Hood, the first one. I bet it's very hard for people to guess what the budget of that is. It's probably not as much as what people might think. So, and yet we pulled it off.
Yep.
I've had many people say that movie looks way more expensive than it is, so.
I'm sure it must have been the scene when I was in the river and I said, never! Oh, Jamie, why did we not shoot that scene again? Why didn't you tell me I looked like such an idiot?
How many times did we shoot that scene, dude? I'm thinking that was the scene we reshot the most.
That's it, because what's his name, Scott?
Yeah, Scott Knobloch. But look,
killed me with that staff.
No, listen. See. Here's the thing. The first time we shot that, and by the way, I think that scene was one of the first scenes we ever shot. I think that was one of the first filming days, which was back in 91, I think, where we shot that at Sipsey Wilderness at the Bankhead National Forest. Yeah. And the first day we shot, everything was out of focus. And I was like, okay, well, this is not going to work. Everything's out of focus. What are we doing? So I was like, well, we've got to go back and shoot it again. And then we went back to Sipsey Wilderness, shot it again, got in the water with the snakes. And then later on, we're like, well, okay, well, that's in focus, but it's not really exciting, and there's not really any good choreography. They're just tapping the sticks together.
It was awful.
They're just tapping the sticks together. Like, they're just
patty cake.
Yeah, there's just patty cake in the sticks. And like, okay, and later on, we decided we need to reshoot this a third time. So that's when we went to Little River Canyon in Fort Payne and got that stunt man to get in there and choreograph some moves, boy.
Lewis.
Yeah, Lewis Borden.
Have you talked to him?
No, I haven't talked to anybody much except you. And I spoke to Caroline a couple times. She told me she was going to do the podcast, but I haven't heard anything back. So, you know, I reached out to Steve Barker about it. Hasn't heard back. Sean Springer, haven't heard back. I just got a thumbs up from him. So, and I've been also anticipating Ryan Sims to do it at some point. Who knows if that'll ever happen. And I'm still waiting on a response about the remake, the remaster, which I've already spent money on. But it's been an uphill battle to get anything from that. Probably going to end up doing that myself when I have time, because I think the film is worth preserving. If anything, just to honor the memory of the people who worked on it and who are now not with us.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, that's about it. And by the way, John Neely, who I will probably talk to very soon. I'm hoping to have him as my next guest, but we'll see.
Fryer Tuck! Fryer Tuck! I remember chasing him through the woods. Fryer Tuck!
Yeah, John's always been a good friend of mine, and he's a great actor too. It's someone else who I lament has gone underused, a tremendous talent who's been underused.
He is such a great guy and so talented. Love John Neely. Boy, we used to laugh. Oh, we had a good time.
Oh, I know. Well, that's John's specialty. I don't think I've ever met anybody who's made me laugh as much as John. I mean, me and John, and you want to talk about a vinyl collection. You want to talk about some 1960s, groovy music. We'll talk about John Neely. because he and I used to smoke pot and blast that shit for hours on end. I mean, I've listened to so much psychedelic rock at John Neely's house, I feel like my brain is fried. But and he had all the good stuff too. I mean, he had all those vinyl records. He had Hendrix, Jim Morrison, King Crimson, what's it called? The other one. And I love Jefferson Airplane. All those classic albums. We rock those albums, dude.
Does he have We Built This City?
Hell yeah. He's got probably anything.
We built this city on rock and roll. That's when they didn't do so well. I did not like that song.
Yeah, well, no one can always do, you know, good stuff. You know, eventually you burn out, just like with anything.
Oh, speak for yourself, Jamie. I'm still cranking them out.
Yeah, so. Yeah, well, I'm glad to see you're doing well, Jason, and, you know, and what are you taking some kind of witchcraft or taking some, what are you saying you're taking?
Oh, the little potions.
Oh, yeah, you got some potions. And
I got three little bottles of potion. Of herbs and such.
Well, for me, By the way, I have to apologize for not having. I mean, I told you about AG1, right? Because I take that. It's a good vitamin supplement. And it's got a lot of stuff in there for your gut, too.
This is not a commercial, by the way.
I think, by the way, it's. Yeah, I'm not a Joe Rogan shill, I swear. But I feel like it makes me feel. It peps me up because it's got a lot of B12 in it. But at least it does something. Like, I do feel more clear in my head and more energetic when I always take it before I work out too. But the whey protein and the collagen kind of keeps me balanced. And I'm trying to steer clear from carbs, even though I really cheated a lot over these holidays. I've been eating like slices of bread lately. I think I'm off my script. I need to stop.
Shame on you, James.
I've got to get rid of these carbs for life, bro. Because that's how I did it initially, is I just completely cut them out. I mean, I'm still good with sugar. Like, I'm good at avoiding sugar, you know. But boy, do I miss Coca-Cola. Oh, geez. What I'd give for a can of Coke.
I never was into that, except when I was a kid. But don't drink sodas anymore.
When I was a kid, that was like your normal lunch. Like, your mom fixes you a sandwich and some potato chips and gives you a Coke. Like, that was standard in the 80s, man.
But sugar, pure sugar.
And by the way, you can go back and watch. I just watched a movie, an 80s movie yesterday called Mac and Me. It's about this little paraplegic kid who discovers an alien. It's like an E.T. ripoff. Back in 1988, I think. It's like every other meal this kid has, he's like drinking a Coke. And then when the alien shows up, they let the alien sample the Coke.
Of course. I'm sure Coca-Cola paid him to do that.
You know. And yeah, there was a lot of product placement back then, too. There's another movie with Stallone called Cobra. And there's a Pepsi bottle and a Pepsi sign and just not every other scene.
Is that where he's in this old 1940s they didn't make cars during World War
II. Yeah, but no, you're thinking right. No, that he was in that one of those get-ups. It looked like a 1930s gangster car. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
A match in his lip all the time.
Yes, that is Cobra, man. Yes.
Okay, I remember that. That was a bad car, man.
Yeah, man. Well, it's an entertaining movie. That's the type of stuff I like. Like, give me Cobra any day over any of this Netflix and Disney Plus crap. But, you know, I don't know.
I don't know. I like that show. I can't remember. Oh, Space Odyssey. It's where this guy and these robots watch B movies and you see.
Oh, that's Mystery Science Theater.
Mystery Science Theater. I love that show. It's so funny, man.
Yeah.
I like the goofiest things. I watched that last night, actually.
Absolutely.
I'll watch it. It just cracks me up.
Well, I like it too. They show a lot of, make fun of a lot of 80s stuff in that. There's one called Invasion from Mars that they used to do. As a really scared the heck out of me when I was a kid, though. But, yeah, all that stuff. It's, you know, I don't want to live in the past, you know, but there's just something about that time period, for especially for movies, that's very special. Like the 80s, the early 90s. Even the late 70s too. Like those, that's my favorite period for films of all time. So.
Yeah.
Even the cheesy ones. Especially the cheesy ones.
Yeah, a lot of films I would tell, you know, my wife and I would tell our kids, "Oh, this is the greatest. What do you see this?" Then we see it and it's totally not what we recalled.
Oh, I know.
And you're like, we actually liked this. We thought this was great. And you're almost embarrassed that you recommended it.
Oh, yeah. That's happened a couple times to me, too. I get that. But it's like, yeah, because that's, you know, times change. You know, people's sensibilities, people's tastes change over time, you know. But at the time, it was like, yeah, that's like the norm.
The music dates it. But there's some things that are just timeless.
Right. Well, let's not forget the movies of the 40s and 50s also. Very special time. And I'm sure that the people who grew up watching those films felt the same way about them and felt like the movies they were watching in the 80s were crap. You know? I think it's just people's memories and how they feel nostalgic about their past. It has a lot to do with it.
Well, maybe. And, you know, things advance and you remember the feeling associated with that movie, but you may not remember the actual details of it. And then when you go back and watch it, it's like, this is not as great as I remember. But you've matured, you've seen a lot more films, and you're a little bit pickier when you go back and watch an older film.
Yeah, well, I even do something even weirder than that. I even try to imagine, like when I watch one of these old 80s films, I try to imagine, like I was like, I'm alive during this movie. I wonder what I was doing.
Yeah, I do that.
Like, I wonder, like, when they were filming this, I wonder, like, what I was doing at this exact moment.
I do that all the time.
Yep. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of interesting. So, well, look, we're about at an hour, and I don't want to keep you all night, but keep it up with the Elvis stuff, man, because you're the best Elvis of all time, besides him. I'm telling you right now, I'm not even kidding. and also in my humble opinion, you're the best Robin Hood of all time. And keep it trucking, dude. And don't let the bastards get you down, okay?
All right, James. Good to talk to you.
And come back again. And I'm gonna try to get some other people on. Maybe John, maybe Caroline, maybe not. But you're always welcome back, because I love talking to you, man.
Enjoyed it. You take care, Jamie.
You too, buddy. See ya.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Oh!
Time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. Are you still mine?
God speed.